But what's Adon Olam? Adon Olam is a small prayer, not really, statement of faith, yes, 5 sentences in the Ashkenazic tradition, 7 sentences in the Sephardic tradition, 6.5, and 7 sentences in the Yemenite tradition, which really anybody who's been to a synagogue hears on Sabbath, and they sing it, and it's a cute little children's ditty. Well, it's a little bit more than that. It actually, the Chazal told us to say it in the morning when we wake up and at night right before we go to sleep. Our entire daily life is supposed to be surrounded and sandwiched in by Adon Olam. And we're supposed to define our lives as Jews by the meaning of what is inside of Adon Olam. But what is Adon Olam? What's behind it? Who wrote it? We'll get there. Over 3 decades ago, I left the life of secularism that I was born into to find meaning in life through connection to God. At the beginning of my search for meaning, I moved along paths that were acceptable according to American society. After a number of years, I found myself in a joint program, I called it the joint pogrom, between Columbia University and the Jewish Theological Seminary, or Cemetery, of America, better known as the Conservative Rabbinical School. I don't exactly look conservative today. Okay, all through those years of study, my colleagues and I, instead of finding meaning through truth, found ourselves being pulled by the currents of falsehood. Our search for meaning wasn't at all being answered. We found that we were brought further into the clouds of confusion. As time went on, nearly half of that class of students at the Jewish Theological Seminary of America left the movement and went to Orthodoxy. We had realized that the non-Orthodox Judaism showed a world of a mere facade of Torah, which we found was really the embodiment of falsehood. Many of us began to realize that there could not be, we couldn't find meaning there, for meaning can only be found through truth. But let's stop for a minute. Let's speak about what should be obvious, but which today isn't actually so clear. Let's speak about the word truth. Today, the word truth seems to be up for decision. It seems that the norm for some people is to cheapen the infinite value of truth. They say such absurd statements as, I have my truth, and you have yours. And they're both valid. Really? What my colleagues, Mr. Bryant and I, realize is that truth is not relative, and that God does not change to become whatever our present whims might wish him to become. It was at Sinai that Hashem gave the truth, his Torah, to his people Israel. The Torah is his will, his instruction, his hora'ah, on how we need to use his world to search for him and to serve him. The Torah informs us that those who were born Jewish only have one proper path. At Sinai, their ancestors entered themselves and their future generations into an eternal, unbreakable covenant. All Jews must fulfill all of the Torah. As you know, for those not from Bnei Israel, there's a choice. The Bnei Noach, as they are called, can choose to either follow just the list of the Noahide laws, which for them is an absolute obligation, or they can choose, like those at Sinai, to take the eternal, unbreakable covenant upon themselves and upon their children after them. Through this, they become Jewish forever. Whichever group we fit into, we have his truth, because whether it's the 613 or whether it's the 7 mitzvahs, it's Hashem's Torah that has given you these commandments. All other paths simply cloud the way. So let's go back. As I started to say, many of my colleagues began to realize that conservative rabbinical school, we couldn't find any meaning there, for meaning can only be found through truth, as I said, and not through the lies that we were being fed. Some went to Orthodoxy, while others, like myself, had a bit of a winding path. I continued my search for meaning at that time by becoming an extreme activist to save Hashem's people all over the world from difficult situations. At one point, I found myself temporarily becoming a spy in communist Moscow and Leningrad, even having the KGB run after me in the metro in Moscow. Yes, it was just like James Bond, like through the things and jumping out and jumping in. Yes, I actually did it, okay? I only lived through the experience because Gorbachev was in America that week and for his first visit, and I was sent to do some pretty dangerous things, and they said, don't worry, they won't break your legs like your friend who was sent a few weeks before because he's there. So I got away with a lot. And I brought my findings to the White House in hopes of aiding the freedom of my brethren in hostage behind the Iron Curtain. In the USSR, Hashem's children were not allowed to learn Torah or to follow his commandments. There was actually quite a bit of success. 67 people got out because of that trip. Having returned from my spying stint, I was still looking for more meaning, more closeness to Hashem. Soon I found myself making Aliyah and becoming an Israeli citizen because of the First Intifada, and joined the armed forces within 48 hours of landing. My hopes were that I would help Hashem's people to survive against the hatred being shot at them, literally, from within their own borders. These actions, plus some simultaneous other private, let's call it activities, which were involved in securing the escape of some Ethiopians who were being persecuted for calling themselves Jews, still left me searching for more meaning. I was becoming close to my people, but what about God? Don't get me wrong. I followed kashrus, I followed Shabbos, I put my tefillin on every day, but something was missing. I didn't know answers to things which were much deeper. I had left the conservative movement, considered myself Orthodox, so I thought. There was much more that activism didn't answer. It seemed to merely mimic something, this activism, which was much greater, that I did not yet know. I knew that there must be more, much more, that could bring me closer to Hashem. I was left feeling kind of empty. After all those efforts, and I'm sure you can all pretty much relate to that, you put a lot of efforts into the previous groups you were in. Nobody came here from an empty bubble. And when you put a lot into something, and then you want to change because you see that something's wrong, it ain't easy. Having finished my army duty, I wondered what the next step would be. During my years at university, I had tasted Torah, even though it was through the clouds of falsity and the conservative movement. I felt that Torah was beckoning me home. So with my honorable discharge in hand, I went to an ultra-Orthodox yeshiva stateside. My parents were none too happy. There, in the holy walls of the yeshiva, I finally found it. Light, fire, answers, truth. No matter what I asked, these people loved the questions, and they actually had the answers. Or if they didn't have the answer, they said, I'll get it for you in the next few days. And they'd ask somebody who knew more than them, and oh my gosh, there was answers to everything. It was amazing. The path towards truthful meaning just began to get paved. As my learning progressed and the light of Torah started to make the path even clearer, I packed up again, leaving my ex-fiancé behind, thank God, and went back to the Holy Land, to Yeshiva in Yerushalayim. Now, instead of finding any... I hope she's not going to see this tape. okay. Now, instead of fighting enemies with guns, and instead of darting African and communist regimes through scheme after scheme, although some of them were very interesting, I learned how to use Hashem's holy words to guide me while in search for meaning. A decade passed, and while I had my head buried in the volumes of the Talmud, I got married, had some kids, there were more to come, a lot more. I had become a rabbi, and I thought that I had arrived, right? But Hashem made it abundantly clear that no dice. Although my search for meaning was finally on the path for truth, I had by no means achieved the goal. Then one day there was a knock at the door. Sound effects. Rabbi, I need your help. You see, I'm fed up with the lies and the emptiness and the lack of answers. I need meaningful answers, truthful answers, not false ones. What's for sure is I need a new religion. I have so many questions, she said. If you don't mind, could I ask you some? She, and over the years, way over 100 like her, bombarded me with questions that I, the rabbi, had no answers to. Let me just share a few of those questions, and this is just a few. Why did Hashem create the world? And how? Or with what? I heard that Torah sources say that Hashem looked into his Torah, and from or through it, he created the world. But Hashem is spiritual, so where does this lowly physicality come from? And why use physicality at all? Why did Hashem not just create spiritual worlds? Hashem is infinite, and everything is his. So what could he need? What's he missing? A chocolate bar? Well, he doesn't need anything. So why did he need to create me or the world? If there's nothing outside of Hashem, so what was it that he was looking for that he needed to create a world? What purpose can our minuscule lives have in the eyes of he who is infinite? Think about it this way, Rabbi. If the scale of meaning goes from infinity, from one to infinity, and let's say that I'm worth 10 million points of meaning, divide 10 million by infinity. It equals absolute zero. This being the case, how can we matter to Hashem at all? How or why would the infinite care about my physical and finite actions or my thoughts? It does not seem to me that God needs little old me. And therefore, why should I act as if my actions matter to the Almighty? Isn't this just some type of a self-importance trip? Maybe the Epicureans were right. Let's just eat, drink, and be merry, because tomorrow we're going to die. Since Hashem is infinite in time, so what was he doing before the creation of the world? Why is there so much evil? And is the Satan God's enemy? If so, then Hashem is really not infinite. For if he has an enemy outside of him, fighting against him, an anti-God, then there's obviously something other than him. And what would it mean that he is not? And that would mean that he's not infinite. What really is the difference between the Jewish concept of monotheism from that of all other concepts in the various world religions? Isn't monotheism monotheism, however you turn it around? What about the afterlife? I've heard such a medley of ideas about what Judaism holds. Could you give me some clarity? And while you're at that, what about the B'nai Noach? Good people from other faiths who follow the seven mitzvahs that Hashem gave to those who are not Jews. Do they have part in it, in the afterlife? Or are they damned in Judaism's eyes like the other major religions view those who do not think exactly like them? And if, as I have heard, Judaism does not view the B'nai Noach as damned, then why should I work so hard to become Jewish and follow 613 commandments? Why not just stay a Ben Noach? Since Hashem gave the Noahide laws, he must have known what he was doing, and the non-Jewish inhabitants of the world are just doing Hashem's will by following these laws. Why should I at all choose to become a Jew, or should I? And should I take on these laws that were not given to me by the Almighty? Others whom I ask on my path have said that I don't need to. There's no need to. But something's really bothering me about this. There seems to me to be more behind the picture. Are they hiding something from me? Could you give me clarity once and for all? No beating around the bush. I'm sick of it. These questions are just a sniff of the onslaught of queries coming my way by prospective converts and already Jewish yeshiva and seminary students sent to me by yeshivas and seminaries where they have students who are having problems with their faith. For more than a decade now, these people have been coming in their search for a deeper faith, a deeper understanding. Well, since I didn't have the answers to many of these questions, I decided to ask rabbis who knew more than myself. I asked Rosh Yeshivas, rabbinical judges, Dayanim. I even got audiences a couple of times with Gedolei Hador, the heads of the generation, the rabbis that no one gets into. Again and again, Adon Olam, a very small liturgical statement of faith, was pointed at as they gave over to me some of the deepest information I have ever heard or read. I began to wonder about this Adon Olam. When different rabbinical figures who had nothing to do with each other all pointed to the same few sentences, it seemed to have the answers to everything, but I didn't really understand myself where it was all coming from. As the years passed and the number of students and their queries grew, I started looking on my own to Adon Olam for the answers before going to the rabbis, a little risky. And then passing some of these ideas before the rabbis, before I gave it to my students. And when I passed it in front of them, my discoveries were called, they said they were right. I was on the right track. I was intrigued to see that all, and I do mean all, of the questions of faith that came my way through the years actually had their answers in these few sentences of Adon Olam. But still, some of the answers seemed at least partially incomplete. As I tried to get to the deeper answers, I noticed that the short text of Adon Olam had a number of terms, Kabbalistic terms, hinting to a greater picture than that which was on the surface. These terms found in Adon Olam refer to Kabbalistic or mystical concepts that are way beyond our grasp. Generally, our rabbis shun us from putting too much of an emphasis upon the learning of the Zohar or going to these Kabbalah centers, which sometimes really distort the truth. Although their teachings in the Zohar are true, they're usually left for the real scholars. I don't mean in the way like the Catholics shun people from looking at the what they call the Old Testament. Anyone can look at the Zohar. But to really study it and understand what it means, if you pick up some books about the Zohar or Kabbalah, it sounds like cows jumping over moons. You have no idea what's going on. So in order to understand it, you need to really study with somebody who knows what's going on. So it should be left for the scholars, because the death can cause a novice to misunderstand and distort these mystical concepts into heretical views. But as usual, I was more than a little determined, and a little bit headstrong over here, and I was not going to sit back while my students and I did not have the answers. How could these students, both Jewish and not yet Jewish, be turned away empty-handed with flimsy answers to their heartfelt and thought-out questions? I knew that Torah Judaism must have the answers to even the deepest issues. I needed to find out what, and also who, was behind this small text. And the Kabbalistic barrier was an impasse. So I found a special rabbi from a family of great Kabbalists. His uncle was the son of the author of the now most authoritative translation of the Zohar from its original Aramaic, the Sulam, into the Holy Tongue. For over a year, I nearly begged him to teach me Kabbalah. He said, no. When I finally told him that I needed this knowledge in order to teach the masses about Adon Olam, he became silent, and he said, my uncle's holy father, the Sulam, told me that any mystical concept found in any of the Kabbalistic works finds its source in the five sentences of Adon Olam. My eyes nearly popped out of my head. How could that be, I thought. He proceeded to pull a book from the shelf and showed me the statements of the Vilna Gaon, who, by the way, those of you who don't know, the Vilna Gaon is in the past millennia, basically, considered the most intelligent of all the rabbis. If he says it, there's really no going against it. Showed me statements of the Vilna Gaon and his student, Rabbeinu Pinchas Miprotsk, that Adon Olam was written 2,500 years ago by the school of the last prophets. He shut the book and said, and so, if this is your goal, to teach the masses about the secrets held in Adon Olam, I'll teach you Kabbalah. We've been learning until late at night for about 5 years now. Over this time, I have come to understand that Adon Olam is no simple piece of liturgy. The depth of why it was written pierced through the walls of time. It was written to help all of those searching for truthful meaning. Let me go back. A few moments ago, I told you all that Adon Olam was written by the school of the last prophets. What does that mean, last prophets? The Talmud teaches us that for the past 2,500 years, remember that date, just said it before, there have been no prophets. Prophets are unlike any other great people that mankind has encountered since then. They are not just a little better than palm readers. No, they weren't soothsayers. A certain connection, a much more direct connection to Hashem, used to exist, that we have nothing, no idea what it really means. It used to exist from the time of creation, meaning every generation there was a prophet. There was never a year from the time Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden until that last school of prophets had Ezra, the scribe, die. There was never a year that there was not a truthful prophet around in the world. I'll tell over to an event of what happened when those people, the same authors of Adon Olam, did something that caused prophecy purposefully to end. And that's why Adon Olam was written. During the times of prophecy, a person could go to one of these special people and ask, am I on the right path? The guidance would not be a good guess. It would be the word of God. The clarity of service was so much more possible during those times. Since then, we are completely lacking this connection. This claim of the Talmud that prophecy ended 2,500 years ago is quite important. Think about it this way. This means the prophecy was over more than 400 years before the birth of what the Christians call their God. It is approximately 1,000 years before the birth of the so-called prophet Muhammad. So we and our great-great-great-grandparents were all born into a world that is missing this prophetic link to God. Compared to people from the prophetic era, we are spiritual orphans. Or are we? What I found in my studies is that this school of these prophets wrote the text of Adon Olam so that we would not be orphans. Its words were imbued with the answers to all questions about faith for all eras to come. Now I will tell you about that event that occurred in Talmud, in Mesechet Yuma, that occurred during the times of the last school of prophets, which led not only to the end of prophecy, but to the writing of Adon Olam. Let's talk about who these people were. Some of them you may know the figures. Ezra, the scribe. Daniel, Ish Chamudot. Nehemiah ben Haklai. And Mordechai, the man who wrote the Megillah with Esther. They came back from the exile, from the Babylonian exile, to form the new Sanhedrin, build the walls of Jerusalem, erect the temple, get the people back on their feet. They were all prophets. Mordechai was so old, he was actually on the previous Sanhedrin as a young member when the Sanhedrin was destroyed 70 years before. To get on the Sanhedrin, you had to know lots of languages, be a very serious rabbi. This man was ancient. So he came into a situation where we all know that there's free will in the world. In order for there to be free will, we have to have a choice. The choice means there's good and evil. So Hashem creates both good and evil so that we have the ability to choose. When the temple was rebuilt and the people were given a chance once again to serve Hashem completely, that's an increase in the powers of good. There was also, in order to keep free choice in balance, an increase in the forces of evil. And so the people had a draw, a real pull towards Avodah Zarah, which is idol worship. So much so that Daniel, Nehemiah, Ezra, and Mordechai said, we will not survive this test. The Jewish people will not survive it. We're not strong enough. We're coming in weak from the exile. Something has to be done. And so they prayed for the removal or weakening of the forces of evil that pulled towards idol worship. But they knew, as the Vilna Gaon says, Zele umat ze asah et Elokim. This against this does Hashem. It has to be in a balance. And so they knew when they were praying for the removal of the force of evil, of pull towards idol worship, they were also going to remove permanently from the world the forces of prophecy. We're going to leave everybody as an orphan forever. How could you survive without prophecy? The world had never known a single minute without prophecy. From the creation of the world to then, it was one of the major conduits to be able to serve Hashem. There was always somebody in your generation, alive and not senile, that you could go to that was actually able to say, Hashem speaks to me. And it wasn't some charlatan. This was going to end. So they wrote Adon Olam. And they put their prophetic powers into Adon Olam. And inside of the text, they knew that the answers to whatever would happen, whatever Holocaust, Inquisition, whatever tragedies, whatever happened to any human being, in their own personal life or for the people as a large, the answers were put into these few sentences. So after understanding the importance of Adon Olam, I buckled down to read everything I could find on the subject. There's a lot. So with my newfound knowledge, I was able to more readily answer my students' queries. Till one day, Dayan Wiesel, that means judge, he's one of the head judges on the based in the Bnei Brak, told me, didn't ask me, he told me, oh no, sorry, well, that's the next part of the sentence, sorry. He told me that my students who were being prepared for conversion were actually coming in better than all the other people. I said, thank you very much. He said, yeah, and that's because of the lessons you're giving on Adon Olam, so you're going to write a book. I said, oh, come on. He said, I didn't ask you. You have to write a book. That's an order from the Beis Din. That could take years. He said, go ahead. He said, we know at the Beis Din that the lessons that you give over are important not only for potential converts, but for the Jewish world at large. He didn't, like I said, he didn't give me a choice. It had to be done. When it was written, a few years later, I went to the Rosh Yeshiva at Or Sameach, who's the man who was responsible most for my learning, and presented him with it. So Rabbi Mendel Weinbach, Zatzal, meaning may he rest in peace, saw the information, read it all, said, it's boring. No one's going to read it. He says, it's true, but it's really boring. He said, you have to write this one as a novel. After about 4 years of research, I kind of felt like the floor dropped out from under me. I said, I'm going to get the guts to say this. I couldn't believe I actually said this. I said, has the Rosh Yeshiva lost his mind? A novel? It couldn't possibly contain all of this information. He said, see you in a couple of years. Okay. So, as the novel developed, the Rosh Yeshiva, Dayan Wiesel, and the Kabbalist, and maybe most importantly, my students, had their eyes and hands on every paragraph of this book. And of course, as the book developed, my students didn't stop bombarding me with more questions, which had to also, of course, be included in the book and have it rewritten again and again. And the forming novel of Adon Olam, A Search for Meaning, encompassed these students' questions and answers. Before the last and most controversial section was written, the Rosh Yeshiva became fatally ill with cancer. In his last weeks of life, he read the nearly completed manuscript. Just to understand what was going on, I brought the first copy of the book to his wife on the way home from the printer before he got on the plane. She saw it before my wife. She said to me, he was sitting there when they had stopped the chemo and were just giving pain medications. I was propping him up and someone was turning the page. He gave the book its title, and signed his approbation with the condition that the manuscript, which was not yet finished, have the last section okayed by Rabbi Wiesel at the Beis Din. After the Rosh Yeshiva's death, I wrote furiously, and I showed Rabbi Wiesel the finished, so I thought, last section. He was unimpressed. Again, I rewrote it. Still, he had what to say about my ideas. So one night I decided, I'm not gutless, I'm going to do this. I went to his home and I said, let's make a deal. You write it. I'll put it, you do the research, you write it, I'll put it into the story form. He said, yes. Can you believe it? So the last section was written by him because it was so complicated and it's about the afterlife and there are so many opinions, I needed to know that it was correct. Okay. He said, he said to me that night, before I will do this, you have to know how important this book is going to be to the public, and that is the only reason why I'm agreeing to do this. Before I read you the first few pages of Adon Olam, A Search for Meaning, let me speak for a moment about the cover. You'll notice that the cloud cover on it is thick. Yet there is a small break through these dense billows which sheds a beam of light on the words, A Search for Meaning. The words Adon Olam, which translate as infinite and personal master of the hidden world, are emblazed on the clouds. Only through attachment to this infinite and yet personal master can we understand the meaning of our lives in the cloudy thickness of this physical world. It is the physical world, which Kabbalistic sources call clouds, which purposely hides from our minds the higher spiritual reality of the master of all and the makeup of what physicality really is. These same sources express that we and the whole creation came into being only so that we could pull away or make a break in these clouds, so that we could find he who chooses to hide behind them. How do we pull away the clouds? How do we understand behind the medium that we are found in? The novel opens with a quote from the Rosh Hashanah services, which reflects just this point. The Supreme King, he is wrapped in a light that can illuminate night as day, and know that even though a thick cloud conceals him, the light still dwells with him. Forever shall he reign. So let's peek into Adon Olam, A Search for Meaning. No, I'm not going to read that much, don't worry. Okay. I know you. I've seen you around, and I've been waiting for the right moment to speak to you. Believe it or not, I was written nearly 2,500 years ago just for you. I know there are many Jewish concepts that confuse you. You feel that there is more to Judaism, much more than you presently understand. You are yearning to connect with a bigger picture, but you don't have any idea how to find it. Sometimes you are frustrated because you don't even know what questions to ask. I know your feelings, and I know your questions. I have known the questions of searching souls like yours throughout all the generations. Your grandparents may have sang my words. Your ancestors taught me to their children. I was carried throughout history into every Jewish city and home. Through the tortures of Auschwitz, I was faithfully recited. In the fires of the Inquisition, Jewish men and women whispered my words. I am still sung today, from England to Yemen, from Australia to Kazakhstan. There is no sect of Jews that has not heard of me. I have all the answers that you have been looking for. Oh, you want to know who I am? You probably think of me as a children's song. I am that prayer that you have heard sung in synagogue since your youth. They call me Adon Olam. Ah, I see your incredulity. Do not be fooled by my simple appearance. When you come to understand the secrets that I hold, all your confusions will vanish. I was written to be the answer when there was nobody left to give it. I was written to light a path for our people through every kind of darkness that would envelop them. I know this may sound strange, but some of the greatest men in history imbued my few short stanzas with wisdom beyond space and time. I am alive, searching soul. No matter what you have come from, and no matter what you have gone through, my words are instilled with a secret message, especially for you. Is this too extraordinary to comprehend? Imagine that you owned a computer that would never need to be updated. The technological advances built into it would never be outdated, never be surpassed. Its programmers preempted any advancement that could ever be created. Your computer would never become obsolete. It would never arrive at an equation that it could not solve. Such a computer would only dimly mimic the power that our holy sages instilled into my words. I have lasted through the most grueling eras, yet my ability to answer our people's questions will never be exhausted. Now, after all the millennia, it is finally your turn to receive these answers. Now, when you need me the most, and my authors knew that you are worth helping. So take my hand, searching soul. Trust me to guide you. There are answers to questions that now seem unanswerable. Your transformation through my words will leave you whole and finally able to call yourself a true servant of Hashem. We are about to embark on a mission that will close all the breaches between you and your Creator. Do you dare? Even when a heart has lost the courage to hope, the truth is still out there, waiting. I am now waiting for you. Searching soul, my authors knew of the difficulties that would challenge your faith, and my words were composed to help you not only survive the storms, but thrive. Together we will dissect my words until they become your key to the mysteries of the universe. Like so many, you have many unanswered questions about Jewish faith. You examine even the most basic tenets closely as you search for clarity in your confusion, like a blind man sifting through colored jewels among worthless stones. You often feel lost and frustrated. Sometimes you may even find it difficult to hold on to your practice in the face of the unknown. Or perhaps you are amongst those who hold on without knowing why, going through the motions of a living Torah, yet feeling dead inside. Which is worse? Both leave life empty. You, like so many others, yearn to truly understand the truth, yet you are overwhelmed by what appear to be contradictions and dead ends. My authors had your jewels. They untangled the confusion and polished the diamonds. Now I will start to reveal my secrets to you. But let's you and me take the scenic route, where I will introduce you to a few other searching souls much like yourself. The issues that bothered them were already addressed in my words. Pay close attention to how these young men you are about to meet, like you, were never satisfied with mediocrity. The more they learned, the more questions they asked, and the more unexpected answers they received. As we will relive their personal adventures, you will receive the answers to both your asked and as yet unasked questions. As your soul will become intertwined with theirs, you, like these young men, will unlock the wisdom of the ancient sages and will become a possessor of answers. Most of the multiple adventure scenes in this novel are based on real events which happened to my students and me. Yes, you'll be in Russia. Okay. These events were used to bring to life the concepts that would otherwise be beyond standard levels of depth that our society is used to dealing with. Rabbi Sutton, who has authored over 20 books on Torah books, wrote this after he read Adon Olam. Adon Olam, A Search for Meaning, is much more than an exposition of the famous liturgical poem Adon Olam. Through its pages, the reader will journey on an astounding tour of Jewish wisdom. Whether you are a novice or a Torah scholar, you will encounter here some of the most fascinating concepts about God and life that you could ever want to understand. In this work, the author weaves all these concepts together with masterful artistry. I have two suggestions for those contemplating reading this book. Don't be fooled, and don't be apprehensive. While this book is written in the form of a novel, don't be fooled by the enjoyable story and mistakenly put it down thinking that you want something of more content. And for those who think that they might not yet be ready for such depths, don't be apprehensive. This work uses the novel form to enable all its readers to digest these deeper teachings about faith in a pleasant and delightfully adventurous way. Whoever you are, I feel that this book will help you to grow immensely in your faith. I wish you all as much growth in reading this work as I have had. Rabbi Avram Sutton. Now let me read to you the text of Adon Olam itself that contains small variations between the Ashkenazic, Sephardic, and Yemenite community. Now you may be asking this question, wait a minute, wasn't this given by the prophets? How are there different traditions? What I found in my research is that the basic, the Ashkenazim have not subtracted anything from any of the other traditions. All of the other traditions contain the words of the Ashkenazic tradition, which is the base text. But some of the Kabbalistic points are completely missed. There are literally sometimes a word which I could do 50 pages on here, and people just missed it. Like, for example, the word splendor. I wrote for 6 months a section on that one word, and that's when I got into the head rabbi of Israel, and he said, it's correct, which was, you know, but I wouldn't have even known that there was an issue if I hadn't seen the Sephardic sentence, which was afterwards, which said, why don't you look back at what you just said? And that's why there are added sentences. Okay. Just remember, this may sound at first level like, yeah, this is kind of truisms. Each one of these words has got a lot behind it. Adon Olam Asher Malach Beterem Kol Yitzir Nivra. The infinite master of the hidden world, who has reigned before all creation and subsequent formation, Le'es Na'asa B'cheftzo Kol L'Zay Melech Shemo Nikra, was enabled to be called king only upon his will making everything come into being. V'yacharei Kichlos HaKol Levado Yimloch Nora. And when all evil will have completed its purpose, then he will reign alone in unchallenged kingship. V'hu haya v'hu hoveh v'hu yehyeh b'sif ara. He was, is, and always will be in the perfect combination called splendor. V'hu echad v'ein sheni. And he is one, and there is no other, not even me. Laham shilo lahachbira. Who can compare to him or be his comrade? V'hu rishon v'hu acharon l'chol chayme u'l'chol tzura. He is the first and the last to every form and shape. B'li reishis b'li tachlis. He is without beginning and without end. V'lo ha'oz v'hamisra. He is the power that is Torah and the dominion. B'li erech b'li dimyon b'li shinui u'smura. He is without the ability to be evaluated, and he has no ability to be compared to anything. Neither can he be changed or exchanged. B'li chibur, b'li perud, gadol kayach u'gvura. He can neither be attached to nor separated from anything, as he is everything. Great is the shown force and the restraining power. V'hu eli v'chai goeli v'tzur chevli be'et zara. And he is my personal God and my living Redeemer. He is the rock of my distress at the time of my troubles. V'hu nisi u'manos lim nas kaisi v'yom ekra. And he is my battle banner, the one testing me, and also the one who performs miracles for me. He is my refuge. He is the portion of my cup on the day that I call. V'hu rofe, v'hu marpe, v'hu tzofe, v'hu ezra. He is the one who heals, and the one who causes healing to come. And he is the one who is constantly on the lookout to be the one to help. B'yado afkid ruchi be'et ishan v'ya'ira. Into his hands I will deposit my spirit, at the time that I will sleep, and I trust him that I will awake. V'im ruchi gviyasi adonoi li v'lo ira. And the living existence of my body is and will be dependent on my spirit. Hashem is always for me, therefore I will never fear. B'mikdasho tagel nafshi meshichenu yishlach mehera. In his sanctuary my life force will eventually elate. Our anointed Messiah he will send speedily. V'az nashir beveis kadshi omein omein shem hanayro. And then we will sing in my sanctuary. Omein, Omein is the awe-inspiring name. Adon Olam, A Search for Meaning, will enliven the messages that were written thousands of years ago to answer your questions. As the novel develops, you will be enabled to push away the thick clouds that block the way while you are on your own search for meaning. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.